There are many different ways an anarchist society can organize itself, but one of the most widely accepted is a form of federalism. Many anarchists don't like the word government and prefer to use words like free association, union, or alliance, whereas others prefer terms like self-governance. Whatever you call it, how we decide to organize ourselves in an anarchist society is what we're going to talk about today. Hi. My name is Aaron, and this is How Anarcho-Communism Works 201, a show that will explore the technical aspects of an anarchist civilization. For newcomers to anarchism, please check out the How Anarcho-Communism Works 101 series to catch up on the basics. Now, let's get started. So as I've said before, the most comprehensive model of an anarchist slash libertarian socialist organizational structure that I have seen is something known as democratic confederalism, though my version of it might be slightly different than the common consensus. Democratic confederalism is a system of democratic self-organization with the features of a confederation based on the principles of autonomy, direct democracy, environmentalism, feminism, multicultural. Culturalism, self-defense, self-governance, and elements of a sharing economy. It takes a critical look of anarchist and socialist societies from the past and works to enhance the successes and rectify the flaws. It also focuses heavily on saving the environment from global catastrophic climate change through decentralization. So, let's take a look at the basic structure. Essentially, all communities are locally organized, with different groups organizing together to form unions. The unions vote on policy and elect/randomly select councils of delegates who can be retracted at any time. These delegates would form a council and would enact policy that was based directly on votes. Those councils would then link together with other councils on different municipal levels to form a federal council, and that federal council can help to enact policy on a national level. So that's the basic premise, but we're going to go through it in much finer detail. First, we focus on your local community, the roughly 100 or so people that live closest to you, maybe on your block or even in your apartment complex. Each community is naturally comprised of several different groups that overlap with each other. Some of these people may be plumbers or chefs or factory workers, but they may also be Christian or LGBT or disabled. In the past, these different groups were the sole focus of representation of various different movements. Syndicalists focused on the worker, individualists focused on the individual, liberation movements focused on gender, race, or ethnicity, and environmental movements focused on, well, the environment. But all of these aspects must be incorporated to have a functional society. Only focusing on one or the other will not create a successful, long-lasting revolution or community. For a machine to function properly, all of its parts have to also function properly. So in our fictional anarchist community of roughly 100 people, each one of those groups could unionize together as a single collective, with respect to their various political and sociological backgrounds. Each department within an organization, business, or union would be able to hold meetings that allow each person to voice their opinions and policy ideas that can then be voted on by the members of that group. Those positions would formulate the policy proposals the union representatives would take to the General Assembly. They can then elect or randomly select representative delegates from each group to function as a voice in the community council. In that community council, each group could outline what needs they have and vote on policy to address them. This would create a face-to-face democracy and direct involvement in one's community, while also eliminating the tyranny of the majority, as all people will have a seat at the table, if you will. As stated before, each delegate could be randomly selected, or cycled through in rotation so everyone that wants to have their voices heard would be able to get a chance. So, on a neighborhood level, all of the people in the tenants' unions that live and maintain the apartment complexes and houses and residential areas would select a tenants' union delegate. All of the laborers in various construction, cooking, factory, and farming unions would select delegates from each one of those. Pro-environmental activist groups, LGBT groups, liberation groups, and religious groups could all do the same. All of these delegates could assemble locally in a town hall format or general assembly. They would then take the arguments and policy ideas outlined by each group and formulate them into comprehensive positions and discuss various problems and solutions that can then be voted on by the local community. The organizers in each group would function as facilitators of said policy and work to organize the communities on cooperative projects, collaborate with other councils, and mediate contracts and pacts made between people within the community. Now, if many organizations fit into broader categories with shared interests, then those groups could also unionize together into larger interest groups and select a single delegate to represent their unified position in the assembly. This is to reduce the number of individual delegates in a single room and focus the conversation on specific policy. For instance, the plumbing, electrical, roofing, and carpenter unions could collaborate under the General Union of Labor. Different religious sects could form a general union of spirituality, different branches of science could form a general union of scientists, and so on. Moving outward, specific delegates could be elected or randomly selected from the entire society, say a city, community, or province, and they could represent the mutual interests of everyone in that local area. On the federal level, these councils would work to organize and facilitate resources and supplies necessary for the local councils to be able to perform their duties adequately, allowing the community itself to have control over what happens within that community, leaving the federal councils without any dictatorial control, only the ability to facilitate what the local councils need. You vote on policy, not a politician. The collective will of the people is what is actually in charge and not a flawed individual leader. Every representative would be immediately revocable and directly responsible to the communities they represent. If they make a policy proposal that does not reflect the direct will of their constituents or is deemed unfavorable, they can be taken out and replaced. Now, on an international level, as for talking to other world leaders or international delegates, the people can always elect a professional diplomat or council of diplomats that are able to build relationships with other world leaders. They would have no authority or power, but they could shake hands and represent the Federation of Anarchists, similar to a UN representative. So in conclusion, democratic confederalism works to bring various different groups into the playing field on an equal level. It allows for individual autonomy and personal freedom without negating the need for collective responsibility, and helps to reduce the tyranny of the majority by allowing every group to have a seat at the table. All of the decisions that are made through the people that vote on those decisions, and not by some politician or bureaucrat 1,000 miles away. And each person that is elected or selected to be a representative is immediately revocable and directly responsible to the communities they represent. And that's basically it. I hope you found this video informative, and please do check out our next episode. It's going to be on emergency disaster situations. So look forward to that in a few weeks, and with all that being said, keep evolving.